Main biology of the flytrap. It is one of the most well-known plants in the world, a fascinating example of nature's capacity for innovation. The Venus flytrap, found in the wetlands of North and South Carolina, this incredible plant is a marvel of natural selection. Through a combination of features that set it apart from most other plants, the Venus flytrap has evolved an extremely efficient way to get what all plants need to survive, nutrients. These include things like nitrogen and phosphorus, which are found in lots of living things, but which plants in general, and the Venus flytrap in particular, can't get out of the air or the soil. Venus flytraps can only get these nutrients by capturing and eating live things, mainly insects and spiders. The process by which the plant catches and digests this prey is one of the most extraordinary things about it, and has fascinated scientists all over the world for well over a century. Yet, even after all this time, there are still many things that we don't know about how the flytrap pulls off this amazing trick. This is partly because lots of different things about the plant. Everything from its genes and its cells to the way it behaves in the wild all come into play to make it work. Anatomy of a flytrap. The Venus flytrap, which has the scientific name Dionaea muscipula, is a carnivorous plant that catches and digests animal prey, mostly insects and arachnids. The trapping structure is formed by the terminal portion of each of the plant's leaves and is triggered by tiny hairs on their inner surfaces. When an insect or spider crawling along the leaves contacts a hair, the trap is shut. This sounding of the hairs being touched twice over 20 or so seconds confirms that the trigger is indeed an animal worthy of trapping. The requirement of redundant triggering in this way serves as a safeguard against wasting energy by trapping raindrops or other inanimate objects. Once the trap is shut, the plant's digestive juices, which contain an enzyme called phosphatase, go to work to dissolve the soft parts of the insect. This process takes at least 5 or 6 days. Some of these plants have actually been famous for their lightning-fast reaction to trapping prey. The Venus flytrap is one of a very small group of plants capable of rapid movement, such as the fall of the sensitive plant, a fern. Only the exterior of the trap is covered in these hairs. As a result, it is possible to stroke the plant, and nothing will happen, because the hairs outside the trap do not trigger its shutting mechanism. How the flytrap catches prey. There are small hairs, called trichomes, on the inner surface of the lobes. As a prey animal touches these hairs, the lobes sense the movement. If a second touch is detected within about 20 seconds of the first one, the trap will snap shut, with the trichomes acting like the deadbolt on a door. Once the trap is closed, the plant will begin to produce digestive juices in the stomach at the bottom of the trap. Over time, the plant will slowly absorb the nutrients released from the dead insect. It is interesting to note that the trap will only close if the first touch is followed by a second one. The plant needs to be sure that there is something alive in the trap before it goes to the effort of digesting it. Also, the plant will only respond to movement. Simply touching the trichomes does not trigger the trap shut. This is a clever evolutionary strategy, as it prevents the plant from wasting energy in shutting the trap when there is nothing to digest. The trap will close at different speeds depending what is being hunted. Tests have shown that the plant can recognize the struggles of different animals. Originally, it was thought that the Venus flytrap was only able to catch very small insects. However, it has since been discovered that the fast trap has the ability to catch and digest things such as crickets, spiders, snails, and even small frogs. Furthermore, traps that catch larger insects have been shown to reopen quicker. This refutes the idea that digestive glands in the trap would quickly become overloaded by having to digest a larger insect. However, the number of times the trap will shut is limited. Most will only close and reopen no more than 5 or 6 times before they run out of energy and die. This might sound a little strange, that part of a plant can be so clearly linked to the idea of needing to rest and be able to run out of energy. However, it is worth remembering that just like any other living organism, plants use energy from sunlight to carry out any processes that are necessary for life. Fascinatingly, the plant's ability to capture prey and create an environment to digest it has implications for the way that botanists think about the classification of the Venus flytrap. It is widely accepted that this plant is carnivorous. It has evolved to actively catch, kill, and then digest prey. However, until recently, many muriocolictic groups would classify the flytrap in a certain way, largely because of the way that the flowers grow. However, a paper published in 2016 suggests that a close look at the natural environment of the flytrap reveals something interesting. It may sometimes have a different range of pollination vectors to those that are used by other Myriocalyptus species. This means that the Venus flytrap may need to be reclassified into a different Myriocalyptic group based just on the fact that it catches its own prey. Digestion and nutrient absorption. One of the most remarkable aspects of the flytrap biology is its carnivorous behavior. As introduced before, the plant relies on photosynthesis to produce the energy it needs for growth. However, the soil in its natural habitat lacks vital nutrients, such as nitrogen and phosphorus. That is the reason why the flytrap has evolved to develop carnivorous habits. When an insect comes into contact with the trigger hairs inside the trap and stimulates it multiple times, the trap will shut in just around 1 second. This rapid movement not only prevents small animals from escaping, but also minimizes the possibility of trapping dust or other useless objects. The trapped insect now starts its next and unfortunately final journey. The inner surface of the trap, which is called the digestive gland, will start to secrete an acidic fluid containing digestive enzymes. When the small animal is in the process of being digested, its complex organic compounds, such as the proteins and the nucleic acids, will be broken down into smaller molecules. Thus, finally, the nutrients in the dead insect can be absorbed by the leaf cells and be utilized by the plant itself. According to the last year's study conducted by the research team from the University of Oxford, there exists a special attraction between the surface of the trap and the insect. Such kind of spontaneous chemical reaction may explain why the flytrap is so efficient in the digestion process. This discovery not only deepens our understanding on the nutrient absorption of the plant itself, but also provides possibilities for transferring this biological technique into other fields, for instance, medical science. By learning and trying to mimic the process of digestion and nutrient absorption in the leaf of the flytrap, scientists may develop a brand new system for the controlled and targeted drug release in human bodies. Such interdisciplinary explanation and potential applications not only inspire people's enthusiasm in biology, but also shed light on its significant connection with other subject areas and the society. Survival and adaptation. A flytrap lives in often flooded, low-nutrient environments, such as wetlands, seepages, and savannas. It has evolved an extraordinary number of strategies to survive in these environments. Firstly, its capacity to adjust its morphology or shape in response to changes in its environment makes it a unique species. Flytraps exhibit plasticity, which enables the organism to modify its characteristics in response to the changes in its habitat. When nitrogen is missing from the environment, the plant shows the development of carnivory more so than control plants. In addition to the absence of nutrients, the flytrap has to face with oxygen. In order for a plant to survive oxygen-deficient soils, some plants produce aerial roots, pneumatophores, or roots that protrude above the water surface to improve oxygen inflow. However, for the flytrap, low oxygen makes membranes leaky to potassium. This is problematic, considering the fact that potassium is essential for the carnivorous mechanisms to function properly. But the study shows that flytraps have alternative pumping or passive mechanisms that help maintain the proper potassium transport channels. Even more interesting, when these organisms live in the midst of a large competent of other species, natural selection takes place. The most common type of flytrap is the Alisi variety. However, more and more inbreeding produces less and less genetic diversity in the species. This is problematic due to the fact that the flytrap is suffering from a lack of variability in their genetic material. As a result, the Alisi variety has the lowest genetic diversity of those studied. In conclusion, The flytrap's extraordinary number of strategies to survive in nitrogen-deficient and oxygen-deficient environments, such as wetlands, seepages, and savannas, never fails to amaze botanists and researchers. By using modern genetic analytical tools and experimental manipulations, the better understanding and the evolution of high nitrogen tolerance for carnivory development can be found.